scarf. It's time for another session of Masterpiece Theatre. I really enjoy this, frankly. Parting wisdom and youth. The classics and reading, and I guarantee this will put you into a deep, deep, peaceful sleep. Why? Because it's a classic. And I don't know about you, but as much as part of me really appreciates them, it also, there's just something that zones me out. When I'm reading the classics, I really have to focus to stay awake. So prepare to drift away into beautiful slumber. And let's begin the ASMR session. In simple tests, as for instance, that the same sun which ripens my beans illuminates at one stance the same systems of earth like ours. If I had remembered this, it would have prevented some mistakes. This was not the light in which I had owed them. The stars are the apexes of what wonderful triangles. distant and different beings in the various mansions of the universe are contemplating the same one at the same moment. Nature and human life are as various as our several constitutions. Who shall say what prospect of life offers to another? Could a greater miracle take place than for us to look through each other's eyes for an instant? We should live in all the ages of the world in an hour. Aye, in all the worlds of all the ages. History, poetry, mythology. I know of no reading of another's experience so startling and informing as this would be. The greater part of what my neighbors call good, I believe in my soul to be bad. And if I repent anything, it is very likely to be my good behavior. What demon possessed me that I behaved so well? You may say the wisest thing you can, old man. You, who have lived 70 years, not without honor of a kind. I hear an irresistible voice which invites me away from all that. One generation abandons the enterprises of another like stranded vessels. I think that we may safely trust a good deal more than we do. We may waive just so much care of ourselves as we honestly bestow elsewhere. Nature is as well adapted to our weakness as to our strength. The incessant anxiety and strain of some is a well-nigh incurable form of disease. We are made to exaggerate the importance of what work we do, and yet how much is not done by us? Or what if we've been taken sick? How vigilant we are, determined not to live by faith if we can avoid it. All the day long on the alert. At night, we unwillingly say our prayers and commit ourselves to uncertainties. So thoroughly and sincerely are we compelled to live, referencing our life and denying the possibility of change. This is the only way, we say, but there are as many ways as there can be drawn radii from one center. All change is a miracle to contemplate, but it is a miracle which is taking place every instant. Confucius said, "To know that we know what we know, and that we do not know what we do not know, that is true knowledge." I'm gonna read that again. It's good. To know that we know what we know, and that we do not know what we do not know, that is true knowledge. When one man has reduced the fact of the imagination to be a fact to his understanding, I foresee that all men will at length establish their lives on this basis. Let us consider for a moment what most of the trouble and anxiety which I have referred to is about, and how much it is necessary that we be troubled, or at least careful. It would be some advantage to live a primitive and frontier life, though in the midst of an outward civilization, if only to learn what are the gross necessities of life, and what methods have been taken to obtain them, or even to look over the old day books of the merchants to see what it was that stores. What they stored that is. What are the grossest groceries for the improvements of ages? Have had but little influence on the essential laws of man's existence, as our skeletons probably are not to be distinguished from those of our ancestors. By the words necessity of life, I mean whatever of all that man obtains by his own exertions has been from the first or from long use has become so important to human life that few, if any, whether from savageness or poverty or philosophy, ever attempt to do without it. Too many creatures there is in this sense but one necessary of life, food. To the basin of the prairie is a few inches of palatable grass with water to drink, unless he seeks the shelter of the forest or the mountain shadow. None of the brute creation requires more than food and shelter. The necessaries of life for man in this climate may, accurately enough, be distributed under the several heads of food, shelter, clothing, and fuel. For not till we have secured these, are we prepared to entertain the true problems of life with freedom and the prospect of success. Man has invented not only houses, but clothes and cooked food, and possibly from the accidental discovery of the warmth of fire and the consequent use of it, at first a luxury, arose the present necessity to sit by it. We observe cats and dogs acquiring the same second nature. By proper shelter and clothing, we legitimately retain our own internal heat. But with an excess of these, or of fuel, that is, with an external heat greater than our own internal, may not cook properly, be said to begin. Darwin, the naturalist, says of the inhabitants of Tierra del Fuego that while his own party, who were well clothed and sitting close to a fire, were far from too warm, these naked savages, who were farther off, were observed to his great surprise to be streaming with perspiration at undergoing such a roasting. So, we are told, the New Hollander goes naked with impunity, while the European shivers in his clothes. It is impossible to combine the hardness of the savage with the intellectualness of the civilized man. According to Liebig, man's body is a stove, and food the fuel which keeps up the internal combustion in the lungs. In cold weather, we eat more, in warm, less. The animal heat is the result of a slow combustion, and disease and death take place when that is too rapid. Or for want of fuel, or from some defect in the drought, the fire goes out. Of course, the vital heat is not to be confounded with fire, but so much for analogy. It appears, therefore, from the above list, that the expression animal life is nearly synonymous with the expression animal heat. For while food may be regarded as the fuel which keeps us up with the fire within us. And fuel serves only to prepare that food or to increase the warmth of our bodies by addition from without. Shelter and clothing also serve only to retain the heat thus generated and absorbed. The grand necessity, then, for our bodies is to keep warm, not to keep the vital heat in us. What pains we accordingly take, not only with our food and clothing and shelter, but with our beds, which are our night clothes, grabbing the nest and breast of birds to prepare their shelter within the shelter, as the mole has its bed of grass and leaves at the end of its burrow. The poor man is wont to complain that this is a cold world, and to cold, no less physical than social, we refer directly a great part of our ails. Fuel, except to cook his food, is then unnecessary. The sun is his fire, and many of the fruits are sufficiently cooked in his rays, while food generally is more various and more easily obtained in clothing and shelter. Are wholly or half unnecessary. At the present day and in this country, as I find by my own experience, a few impediments, a knife, an axe, a spade, a wheelbarrow, etc. And for the studious, lamp, light, stationery, and access to a few books, rank next to necessities, and can be all obtained at a trifling cost. Yet some not wise go to the other side of the globe, to barbarous and unhealthy regions, and devote themselves to trade for 10 or 20 years, in order that they may live, that is, keep comfortably warm, and die in New England at last. The luxuriously rich are not simply kept comfortably warm, but unnaturally hot. As I implied before, they are cooked, of course, à la mode. Most of the luxuries and many of the so-called comforts of life are not only not indispensable, but positive hindrances to the elevation of mankind. With respect to luxuries and comforts, the wisest have lived a more simple and meager life than the poor. The ancient philosophers, Chinese, Hindu, Persian, and the Greek, were a class that which none has been poorer in outward riches, none so rich in inward. We know not much about them. It is remarkable that we know so much of them as we do. The same is true of the more modern reformers and benefactors of their race. None of these can be impartial or wise observer of human life, but from the vantage ground of what we shall call voluntary poverty, of a life of luxury. The fruit is luxury, whether in agriculture or commerce or literature or art. There are nowadays professors of philosophy, but not philosophers. Yet it is admirable to profess, because it was once admirable to live. To be a philosopher is not merely to have subtle thoughts, nor even to found a school, but so to love wisdom as to live according to its dictates. A life of simplicity, independence, magnanimity and trust. It is to solve some of the problems of life, not only theoretically, but practically. The success of great scholars and thinkers is commonly a courtier-like success, not kingly, not manly. What makes families run out? What is the nature of the luxury which enervates and destroys nations? Are we sure that there is none of it in our own lives? The philosopher is in advance of his age, even in the outward form of his life. He is not fed, sheltered, clothed, warmed, like his contemporaries. How can a man be a philosopher and not maintain his vital heat? Be better methods than other men. Thought I'd change up the mood a wee bit. When a man is warmed by the several moods which I have described, what does he want next? Surely not more warmth of the same kind. As more and richer food, larger and more splendid houses, finer and more abundant clothing, more numerous in houses, incessant and hotter fires, and the like. When he has obtained those things which are necessary to life, there is another alternative than to obtain the superfluities, and that is to adventure on life now. His vacation from humbler toil having commenced, the soil, it appears, is suited to the seed, for it has sent its radical downward, and it may now send its shoot upward, also with confidence. Why has man rooted himself thus firmly in the earth, but that he may rise in the same proportion into the heavens above? For the nobler plants are valued for the fruit they bear. At last in the air and light, far from the ground, and are not treated like the humbler esculents, which, though they may be biennials, are cultivated only till they have perfected their root, and often cut down to the top for this purpose, so that the most would not know them in their flowering season. I do not mean to prescribe rules to strong and valiant natures, who will mind their own affairs, whether in heaven or hell, and perchance build more magnificently and spend more lavishly than the richest, without ever impoverishing themselves, not knowing how they live, if indeed there are any such as has been dreamed. Nor do those who find their encouragement and inspiration in precisely the present condition of things, and cherish with the fondness and enthusiasm of lovers, and to some extent I reckon myself in this number. I do not speak to those who are well employed in whatever circumstances, and they know whether they are well employed or not, but mainly to the mass of men who are disconnected and idly complaining of the hardness of their lots, or of the times when they might improve them. There are some who complain most energetically and inconsolably of any, because they are, as they say, doing their duty. I also have in my mind that seemingly wealthy, but most terribly impoverished class of all, who have accumulated dross, but know not how to use it, and thus have forged their own golden or silver fetters. to spend my life in years past, it would probably surprise those of my readers who are somewhat acquainted with its actual history. It would certainly astonish those who know nothing about it. I will only hint at some of the enterprises which I have cherished. In any weather, at any hour of the day or night, I have been anxious to improve the nick of time and notch it on my stick too, and stand on the meeting of two entities, the past and future, which is precisely the present moment, to toe that line. You will pardon some obscurities, for there are more secrets in my trade than in most men's, and not yet voluntarily kept, but inseparable from its very nature. I long ago lost a hound, a bay horse, and a turtle dove, and am still on their trail. Many are the travellers I have spoken concerning them, describing their tracks and what calls they answered to. I have met one or two who had heard the hound and the tramp of the horse, and even seen the dove disappear behind the cloud. They seemed as anxious to recover them as if they had lost them themselves. To anticipate, not to surmise, and don merely put, if possible, nature itself. How many mornings, summer and winter, before yet any neighbour was stirring about his business, have I been about mine? No doubt many of my townsmen have met me returning from this enterprise, farmers starting for Boston in the twilight, or woodchoppers going to their work. It is true, I never assisted the sun materially in his rising, but no doubt it was of the last importance, only to be present at it. So many autumn, I, in winter days, spent outside the town trying to hear what was in the wind, to hear and carry it express a well-nigh sunk all my capital in it, and lost my own breath in the bargain, running in the face of it. If it had concerned either of the political parties depend upon it, it would have appeared in the Gazette with the earliest intelligence. At other times, watching from the observatory of some cliff or tree to telegraph any new arrival, or waiting at evening on the hilltops of the sky to fall, that I might catch something, though I never caught much. And that, manna-wise, would dissolve again in the sun. However, in this case, my pains were their own reward. For many years I was self-appointed inspector of snowstorms and rainstorms, and did my duty faithfully. Surveyor, if not of highways, then of forest paths, and all the cross-lot routes, keeping them open, and the ravines bridged and passable at all seasons, where the public heel had testified to their utility. I have looked after the wild stock of the town, which gave a faithful herdsman a good deal of trouble by leaping fences, and I have an eye to the unfrequent nooks and corners of the farm, though I did not always know whether Jonas or Solomon worked in a particular field today. That was none of my business. I have watered the red huckleberry, the sand cherry, and the nettle tree, the red pine and the black ash, the white grape and the yellow violet, which might have withered a thousand dry seasons. In short, I went on thus for a long time. I may say it without boasting, faithfully minding my business till it became more and more evident that my own townsmen would not after all admit me into the town, into the list of town officers, nor make my place a sinecure with a moderate allowance. My accounts, which I can swear to have been kept faithfully, I have indeed never got audited. Still less acceptable, still less paid and settled.